Chapter 16, The Long Stumble. We ran. I can't really recall what the packing up was like, or if I even contributed. We were gone from the clearing and into the darkest part of the woods before the sun was fully up. I know I held on to the gun, still warm in my palm, for most of the run, up until we heard the whistles far away, echoing off that cliff, and I swung it back behind me and snapped out of it a bit, just enough to take whatever Rose had in her arms, in addition to her pack, and to run behind to keep her to keep pace. We ran for hours, Cheboy and Meg taking turns carrying Minerva like a child on their backs while she wailed and sang and mewled in cycles. We zigged and we zagged, and when he wasn't packing our distraught elder, Cheboy was off leaving false trail leads for any potential followers, his arm held closed with duct tape since there was no time to properly stitch it up. By evening, we were exhausted. We'd run and mourned for hours, each one of us crying out while the image of Riri came to mind. Riri, in one shiny pink boot dropping off the edge of the rock, held the body of her would-be kidnapper by the iron bar of his arm. Instead of a captor, he became her anchor, dragging her all the way to the bottom. Camp that night was two tents thrown up hastily in the middle of dense bush, with the spring bugs newly awake buzzing at the tears we hadn't had time to repair. We slept with our shoes on, piled together like sticks, falling unconscious more than to sleep. Rose curled around me, but I could barely feel her. Something had changed since I'd fired the gun, since I'd killed Travis. It was like a color had ceased to exist, and now the world seemed dull. Riri was dead. I had killed a man, and there was no taking either of those things back. For the first time in several years, I missed my parents as physical pain at the bottom of my stomach and under each kneecap. That's where the loss lived, in those strangely normal spots on my body. I didn't think I deserved to rub them, so I fell into dreamless sleep with a throb and a pull in my body. The next morning, Wob made sure we each ate a bowl of lukewarm mush in the cold hour before the sky started shedding layers into a light blue. She spoon-fed Minerva, who was now unresponsive, and rag-washed her face and hands before taking her into the bush to pee and then bundling her back up. Her cart had been left back at the clearing, so she'd made a kind of sling to balance the woman's weight on Cheboy's back. A bit warmer now, Tree spoke to Ziguan in whispers. They needed to hear each other's voices. It was part of their coping. It'll be full spring soon. Saw some green on the brown trees. That's good. We didn't have much to pack up, and soon we were on our winding path again, heading everywhere and nowhere, frantic to get away. The next 2 days and nights were much the same, Tree and Ziguan commenting on the weather getting warmer and the bugs coming back. Minerva rode catatonic on our strongest carriers. I was numb. It was the fourth day when Meg called to me from the front of the line. French, get up here, boy. I made my way up while he waited. Before I would have rushed, but now I wasn't sure I even wanted to join him. I wasn't really sure of anything. I wasn't sure I even wanted to run anymore. Maybe I could just sit and wait for the recruiters to pick me up. Maybe I could use the last bullet I had in my gun to just go away. I fell in stride beside him. At first, he said nothing. I didn't want to live after Isaac didn't make it out of the school, he said. I'd escaped, sure, but why? I had no life without him. The only thing that kept me going was the promise I'd made to myself to go back, to get Isaac the first chance I got. At first, I had to run, of course. The second they realized the laundry boy was no longer in the laundry room, they would comb the area, so I ran. For 2 days and two nights, in my bare feet in a uniform that looked like men's pajamas. It's not as bad as it sounds. At night, I found nooks and holes to crawl into, and anything is better than living in a maze of hallways and sterile rooms, not knowing if the person you care for in the world is alive or dead or hurting, knowing only that he's close by, but impossibly out of reach, knowing only that your people could be strapped into some kind of machine that chews them up and spits out bone mush and sticky sap. It's much better to freeze and bleed a free man. After that, I found a Cree family that was on the run, too. They let me camp with them a bit, gave me food and clothes and information, told me about a small pockets of Anishinaabe still huddled around here and there. Back then, there were smaller communities, like the one you lived in, and that's where I met your dad, walking into a settlement by Huron with the Crees. I felt a sharp jab in my guts at the mention of my father, like a poisonous bubble bursting, one I've been trying to protect in the soft web of my insides. I ate real food and slept for a week. Then I began bartering, trading game and knowledge for clothes and camp gear. And all I needed was a gun. For that, I had to promise to show your dad and his council to the capital. They had this crazy notion that there was goodness left, that someone, somewhere, would see just how insane this whole school thing was. They could dialogue. They could explain the system had to die and a new one be built in its place. Like that wasn't scarier to those still in the system than all the dreamlessness and desert wastelands in the world. I brought them to the borderlands and drew the final roads in. I couldn't walk all the way in with them. I was a fugitive from the school and I needed to get back. I still had to find Isaac. So your dad, he shook my hand, gave me the rifle, and walked away. I remember the way my mother had changed when dad didn't return. Her skin turned to paper, and on it was written all the worries that had ever crossed her mind and heart. I saw his back walking away from Miguan's, out of the safety of the woods and into the unknown of the city. I knew he wouldn't have gone if he hadn't been driven by his love for us, me and Mitch. I was listening with every cell, desperate to pick up a new piece of information or add a new color to the picture that was my father's last days. Of course, Mig had still told me the story before, more than once when I bugged him, but it always ended right there. This time, he continued. After that day, I walked back to the school. It took about 11 days, and in every hour of those 11 days, I imagined what I would do when I got there. There were murder fantasies and romantic reunions. I imagined snapping necks and then picking up my bay and running into the woods. Of course, it was all bullshit. When I got to where the trees thinned into forest meadow, devoid of grass, the air empty of birds, I could barely keep myself from pissing my pants. So I sat down. What? I just sat. Sat there for 2 days, watching the windowless walls. For what? I'm not sure. I wasn't sure of anything. I didn't even cry. I just sat. I knew damn well there was no way in, and not even a window to break in through. What was I going to do? It was a suicide mission that wouldn't get me any closer to Isaac than I was sitting in the woods. The morning of the third day, a pickup truck rumbled past me. I waited near the fence gate for it to leave again, and jumped in the back, squeezing in between two piles of wooden crates under a blue tarp. I rode along for hours until it stopped on the side of the road, and the driver got out to relieve himself. When he was finished zipping up, I snuck behind him and put the gun to his spine. He raised his hands in the air. Oh shit, what do you want? Take the truck, keys are in the ignition. I don't want the damn trunk. I want into the school, and I know you can get me there. He turned then, curiosity getting the better of fear. He took in my appearance, from my shaved head to the gun I held in a steady grip. Dude, what do you want to get into the school for? You're an Indian. Indians go there to die. What do you mean? Indians go there to get harvested. He shrugged his shoulders and chuckled without mirth. What do you think harvesting is? They work them, I mean you, until there's enough demand built up, then they hook you up and game over, man, it's done. I punched him in the gut, a cheap shot, so angry I couldn't hold it in. The air rushed out of him and he fell to a knee in his own piss. Where are they? Where in that godforsaken building are the people? It took him a minute to catch his breath. I wound up to kick him in the side before he put a hand up to stop me. Gone? What do you mean, gone? Where the hell are they? Then I did kick him. He fell to his side and held up both arms in front to protect his head. They're gone. There's no one there now. Last group was used up. They're waiting on new recruits. He yelled at me from behind his arms. I paced in a small circle, hands on the back of my head, gun clattering against my skull, then reeled back to the driver, who was still in his defensive curl, eyes closed. I don't believe you. He pointed to the truck. Check the back. I kicked at his legs, just grazing a shin. Don't get smart with me, asshole. Dude, just look in the back. That's the last of them. I looked behind me at the truck, then back to the prone man. Don't move. He lifted both hands in the air in a gesture of surrender and stayed on the ground. Keeping the gun pointed in his direction, I walked back to the truck and lifted the side of the tarp. Just crates. I yanked it off completely, and still, only crates. I took 2 steps backwards to the man before he called out, "Look in the boxes, man, the boxes." I pulled a crate off the top of a stack and dropped it by my feet. I yanked on the top and the nails gave way. Inside were rows of glass tubes held in a metal rack and cushioned by plastic wrap. What the? I took one out. It was a frosted test tube with a shadow of liquid inside, a thick, vicious liquid that was neither cool nor warm. I turned the tube, and on one side there was a paper label, 67541B, 23-year-old male, Odadwa Micmac. I grabbed another, 46522Y, 64-year-old female, Métis. No. 6781F, 15-year-old male, Inuit. No. 66542G, 41-year-old male, Euro-Cree. I didn't think. I didn't consider. I walked back to the driver and started shooting. It wasn't even his fault. He was just a cog in the system. Not that he didn't know what was going on, but still. We had slowed down. The sun was setting. Mig motioned for Chiboy to go ahead to scout the next campsite. Then he continued. I didn't kill him. Not right there. I hurt him bad, though. Shot him in his arm and a thigh. He was bleeding pretty badly and crying. He cried hardest when I drove away with his truck, leaving him there all alone. That was the worst part. He pleaded with me to take him, but I was deaf to him then. Not that I wouldn't hear him clearly later when I tried to sleep. I loaded the crate in the back and just drove away with them all, knowing leaving the driver meant he would die slowly and without dignity there on the side of the road. What did you do with it? With the dream stuff? I couldn't help myself. I had to ask. It was too late to save Isaac. I took too long. I had to live with that, but I couldn't live with the people being served up like a club sandwich to the dreamless. So I tried to take them home. I drove to the lake, one of the last ones I knew still held fish, got as close as I could from the road, and then trekked in, back and forth, one box at a time. Then I camped there for 4 days. I sang each of them home while I poured them out. It rained, a real good one too, so I know they made it back. Chiboy loped back and guided us to a swatch of even ground under a ridge of thick pine where we'd spend the night. The group started unloading. I stepped forward to drop my pack and set up, but Meg grabbed my shoulder, holding me there for a moment. Thing is, French, sometimes you do things you wouldn't do in another time and place. Sometimes the path in front of you alters. Sometimes it goes through some pretty dark territory. Just make sure it doesn't change the intent of the trip. He put his right hand in the center of my chest. As long as the intent is good, nothing else matters. Not in these days, son.